In 1983, the Soviet Union nearly started a nuclear war by accident, twice. At the time, it was the Cold War and tensions were high. Ronald Reagan was America's new president, and just 3 weeks earlier, the Soviets detected an aircraft flying towards Sakhalin Island on the Soviet Pacific coast. Suspecting it to be an American RC-135 spy plane, they shot it down. With that, the Cold War entered a new and dangerous phase, and both countries were on a hair trigger. After midnight, on September 26, 1983, deep underground in the Serpukhov 15 Nuclear Forces Command and Control Bunker near Moscow, the Soviet Union's network of early warning satellites suddenly blared a warning. At least 5 intercontinental ballistic missiles were detected coming over the Arctic. For the men in the bunker, this was the nightmare scenario that they had trained for. Everyone knew that each of America's Minuteman III missiles carried 5 nuclear warheads, each with the equivalent explosive force of 170 kilotons of TNT, 12 times the size of the bomb that destroyed Hiroshima. This was exactly the direction from which the Soviets assessed an American missile attack would come, directly over the Arctic, the shortest distance between America's missile bases in the Midwest and Moscow. The mission of the Serpukhov 15 bunker was simple. When the first American missiles were detected, they were to immediately launch the Soviet Union's massive nuclear retaliation. Contrary to what many thought, the Soviets recognized that there was a way for America to win a nuclear war without destroying the world. They called this a decapitation strike, a type of attack that targeted the Soviet Union's leadership and military command and control infrastructure. If successful, it would leave the Soviets without anyone left in charge to order a counterattack. To counter that threat, the Soviet Union's policy was to launch not when the first missiles hit, but when they were first detected. If a war started, the men in the Serpukhov 15 bunker knew that they would be the first to die. Their bunker was charged with ordering the Soviet Union's massive nuclear retaliation. It was one of the key sites to hit in a decapitation strike. Incredibly, because it was late at night, despite the importance of the bunker to the Soviet air defense forces, all of the generals were at home, asleep in their bed. The decision to launch that night rested on the shoulders of one man, a mid-level officer named Lieutenant Colonel Stanislav Petrov. Based on Soviet doctrine, Lieutenant Colonel Petrov was expected to do his duty, and that was it. He was required to give the order to launch. Put simply, it was launch or die, or maybe launch and die. World War III was to begin with nothing more than a nod of Petrov's head. And it might have all happened that way, except that Petrov sensed that something didn't feel quite right. Despite the early warning data being confirmed, he decided against launching the Soviet Union's entire missile arsenal. In fact, he decided against launching anything at all. He felt that America would never begin a war like that, and he wondered if Soviet-made computers and satellites were as good as the government claimed them to be. Thus, instead of giving the order to launch, he stood up slowly and got himself a cup of coffee. Then he returned to his desk and waited. His men watched him nervously, wondering if at any moment the American missiles would hit. The time to impact clock wound steadily down to zero. Somehow, the early warning satellites had malfunctioned. America had not started World War III after all, and because of Petrov's decision, neither had the Soviet Union. 2 hours later, a new warning blared. The early warning satellites reported yet another 4 American missiles coming again over the Arctic. And once again, Lieutenant Colonel Petrov waved off the mandatory launch orders, poured himself a cup of coffee, and waited to see if they were about to die. And once again, it was a false alarm. As it happened, based on nothing more than his gut feeling, Lieutenant Colonel Petrov saved the world that night, not once, but twice. What's more extraordinary is that he did it by disobeying his orders, and in doing so, he risked execution, or at the very least, a sentence to hard labor in a gulag in Siberia. But imagine the madness of that. In his position, he was actually required to destroy the world, and if he failed to do so, he faced reprimand, perhaps even death. As it happened, in the days and weeks that followed, Lieutenant Colonel Petrov wasn't executed, nor was he even sent to Siberia. He wasn't even reprimanded. Likewise, despite single-handedly saving the world from destruction that night, he wasn't even given a medal. Instead, the Kremlin covered it up. Later, the scientists worked out that the early warning satellites had detected nothing more than sunlight reflecting off high cirrus clouds over the Arctic. The Soviets had two problems to fix. First, those kinds of reflections had to be filtered out so that they didn't trigger a launch in the future. And second, they had the Petrov problem. How to replace the man in the loop so that the next time a nuclear attack was detected, the system would automatically launch instead of relying on a man. Fittingly, they called that the dead hand. For many months afterwards, America knew nothing about how close the world had come to nuclear Armageddon that night. When the truth was uncovered, it fueled President Ronald Reagan's desire to get the Soviets back into arms negotiations. And for the Soviets, too, the events of that night created new pressure to re-engage with the United States. It took 4 years for both sides to reach out and finally get the job done. And in 1987, America's President Ronald Reagan and the Soviet Premier Mikhail Gorbachev met and they shook hands on the South Lawn of the White House. The two nations took the first step back from the brink. Perhaps the ultimate lesson of the events of that night in 1983 is that one person can make a difference, even against all odds and in the darkest of times. There is another story worth mentioning. One of the drivers that drove the Soviet delegation to the summit at the White House that day was a young colonel in the KGB. His name was Vladimir Putin. And while the two leaders met and talked about peace, Colonel Putin stood by his black Gilles limousine and smoked cigarettes. You might wonder how I know. Well, it's because I was there. And it was years later when I saw the news reports about Putin swearing in as the new leader in Russia when I remembered his face. And who knows? Maybe it wasn't him. Maybe he has a twin. We took his photo, though we lost it long ago, and I remember how he scowled at us. We laughed and we reminded him that he was in America now, not in Moscow. He stared coldly back at us, removed the cigarette from his lips, flicked it to the ground, and then slowly he crushed it under his heel and smiled. I'm Thomas Van Hare, and this is Historic Wings. Please subscribe and consider sponsoring us. And remember, there's always more to the story.